This program is funded by the North Dakota Council on the Arts, the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4th, 2008, and by the members of Prairie Public.
Hi, I'm Bob Dambach, and welcome to Prairie Mosaic, a patchwork of stories about the people and places that contribute to the arts, culture, and history in our region. On this edition, we'll visit an interactive museum focused on the oral histories of war veterans. We'll profile an award-winning area filmmaker and be entertained by a cowboy poet and musician from Mandan, North Dakota. But first, let's visit Minot, North Dakota, where artist Walter Piehl, using acrylic on canvas or paper, treats Western Americana with modern art influences and interpretation.
But I think there needs to be a sort of consistency. Sometimes I'm an artist teacher, sometimes I'm a teacher artist. The pineapple will be so powerful it doesn't matter. Teaching has allowed me to paint what I want, when I want, and how I want. One of the things that I did for my entertainment was draw as a very, very small child. Drawing and imagery always did interest me. And so when it came time to think about going to college, and I wanted to go to college because I wanted to get out of the haystack. I knew there was more world out there, and even though I loved the horse angle, the cattle angle of where I was at, I wanted something more. One of the instructors said, "We hear that you go to rodeos on weekends." And I said, "Yeah, my family's involved in rodeos, this, that." He said, "Well, why aren't you using that as a subject matter?" My reply was, I didn't think it could work. I thought cowboys were inappropriate. They're too romantic. They're too full of adventure in a bad way. He said, "No, that's not true. Any subject is appropriate. And if you want to paint that, you should paint that. But you have to find your own voice. You have to find your own way." The part about rodeo that was the most obvious to me was the action part. The bucking horses, the bucking bulls, the dynamics of horse and rider. And so I looked to the Italian futurist group of the early 1900s. They took cubism and they applied it to moving subjects. Then also I looked to the abstract expressionists, the action painters. The way in which the artist applies the paint to the canvas is important to the look of the finished work. The energy that the artist brings to the paint application should also be communicated to the viewer in the end. And so when I paint, I want people to look at it and say, "Wow, it looks like he did that application of paint with big brushes and a lot of energy," which hopefully enhances the movement of the subject also and the energy of the subject. Paint is a fluid medium that drips and it splatters, and those aren't collateral damage. Drips and splatters oftentimes are collateral enhancements. Sometimes accidents are bad accidents, but sometimes the accident is the best thing that can happen to a painting. I no longer really paint in a futurist, cubist style, but I do use some of the same devices that the cubists and the futurists use, which would be multiple imagery.
1, 2, 3, 4.
I might have a horse with 6, 8, 10 legs, 2 or 3 heads that might be visible in here. As this horse is moving through space, as the rider is moving through space. The process involves a chalk drawing with colored chalk. I'll do a basic composition. After that, I will go into it with a dark linear painted outline of that, to refine that a little bit, to make changes, to give myself something to go by, something that will still show through the first applications of paint. And then Generally speaking, I go to the most fun part, that really spontaneous primary application of paint, where I am applying paint with great abandon, where the energy, most of the energy, will come into the canvas. Then I let that dry, then I go back into it and see what I can do to resolve it, to get rid of the bad stuff, keep the good stuff. After that, it's mostly fine-tuning adjustments.
As this rider moves through space, we'll see this green repeating. I like polka dots and I like angular patterns on shirts for my riders. They add action.
I want to see details in my paintings, but I want them to be very, very abstract in the same way. I don't like the idea that somebody could walk to the painting the first time and just identify everything in there. I want them to find the paintings, reveal themselves as they look at them several times, perhaps.
Well, do you see any of the image in this one, folks?
My favorite paintings that I do are ones that are more abstract. But my tendency to be fussy, I think, causes me many times to go back and work on paintings more than I should. I take them too far.
Some parts of it I might have gone a little too far. And I may regret it a little bit now, but in the end, it may be just fine.
Oftentimes, as a painter and as a teacher, you have to talk to students about knowing when to quit on a painting.
I have no doubt you can probably take it and make a really nice painting out of it, but it is a really nice painting right now.
They have such a strong mental image of what they think this thing is to look like that they give up some wonderful, fresh, spontaneous, simple images to begin with.
You have to recognize when you have something that's good and stop on it at that point, even if it doesn't match that mental image that you have for an idea of what I want to do in this painting.
Taking a painting too far is the easy thing. Recognizing when to stop on it, that's the difficult part of it.
ITOW, the In Their Own Words Veterans Museum, resides in Pahrump, Minnesota. It's an interactive museum focusing on the oral histories of area war veterans from World War I to the present.
Welcome to the ITOW Veterans Museum in Pahrump, Minnesota. This is a very unique museum that is based on the oral histories and the recorded stories of area veterans. My name is Lina Ballar. I'm the Executive Director of the Friends of the History Museum of East Ottertail County. Most of these exhibits are very interactive. We have videos that you can watch that we'll just be repeating over and over again. We also have touch screens so you can choose different people to listen to. So it's a way to make an even more personal experience of the tour. And it's also a way to make it different every time that you come because you're not going to experience everybody's exhibit the first time through. So you can come through many times and hear different stories all the time. What you'll hear is stories from area veterans from all walks of life and all eras, from World War II, from World War I, from Vietnam, and even the Cold War era and Korea, you know, telling you what it was like for them when they went to join the military or when they went into battle for the first time.
Another friend of mine went down to St. Paul and we took a physical. I passed and he had a spot in the lung when the Army would take him.
Because we're in a rural area, I think that experience is much more apparent and much more intimate than if you're often in an urban area where maybe things can happen next door you don't even know about. In a rural area, everybody sort of knows everybody, and I think that made it a different experience in terms of design. Many, many people in the community and the town supported it, and also the state. We were able to get some state funding and eventually get some federal funding for it because these are stories that transcend just what happened in Pahrump, Minnesota. The interviews come from people from probably 60 to 100 mile radius, but their stories are very universal because even if it wasn't your father that served in the Battle of the Bulge that you see, whose story you hear, perhaps you know someone who did. And I've had people come through and say, now I know what my father would have told me had he lived to tell me. And so it becomes an experience that throughout the whole nation, people can relate to these stories because you knew someone who did have that experience. So we started collecting oral histories, and we worked on that for a number of years and got some additional funding to broaden our base so that we were able to record more than just the local veterans, but spread out a little further through the state, and also to do a project recording women and their experiences not only in the military, but also on the home front. 2004, we're still thinking about where we might have this kind of museum, and the VFW suggested that we use the existing VFW building as a museum. So then we began actually doing the physical plans to put that together and create what you see today. So when it came down to designing the Veterans Museum, we have a local architect that has done a great job with looking at ideas for the exterior and also some of the things on the interior. We opened the museum in the August of 2006, and we continued to make additions and additional exhibits to the museum. And of course, in our big gallery, we have a documentary that plays all day, every hour on the half hour. But in addition to that, it's also a space where we have traveling exhibits. Perhaps you had a relative who served in World War II, but they never told you their stories. And you know, when you come here, you'll get an idea of what it was that they carried around in their heads and their hearts their whole life, and perhaps weren't able to tell you. Each one of these men and women, they've served, and they've served without question. Not because they wanted to, or they wanted anybody else to do it, but because it had to be done. One of the great things about this museum in terms of providing a service to the public, I think it also provides a service for veterans, because the chance to tell their story is a healing experience as well. And I think it's a way to help heal not only veterans, but the communities too, to understand what people go through to preserve their freedoms.
Award-winning Moorhead, Minnesota filmmaker Tom Brandeau has been making independent films for nearly 30 years. The Baltimore native has a unique and soft touch in the way he crafts his films. Now, he's passing that knowledge onto future filmmakers at Minnesota State University Moorhead.
I work on the 19th floor, Ordinary Policy Department, Premium Accounting Division.
When I was about 20 years old, I saw the Billy Wilder film, The Apartment, for the first time. And when I was watching it, there was something about it, the dialogue, that just seemed awfully familiar, even though I knew that I'd never seen that film before. I think it was over Thanksgiving dinner, I actually mentioned this to my mother, and my mother just looked at me and laughed, and she said, "Well, when you were born, it was in late August, you were overdue. I would go to the theater every day and watch a film, and it just so happened that they were running The Apartment. So I must have seen The Apartment something like 10 times while I was waiting for you to actually be born." Who knows, right? The moment for me when I figured out that I wanted to be a filmmaker for a living didn't happen until college, even though the roots went further back. My undergrad was at a small university, Towson State University in Baltimore.
From the stripping of the blubber.
My thesis project as an undergraduate was a documentary that I made in Iceland about Icelandic whaling. I ultimately sold that to the Discovery Channel, and it was also nominated for a Student Academy Award. So I decided to apply to the AFI, the American Film Institute, in Los Angeles. And I applied as a directing fellow. I did not consider myself a director before I went to that institute. And when I got out, I was a director.
Cut! All right, thank you, gentlemen.
Feature filmmaking is not for sissies. There are so many ways that you can fail as a filmmaker. I mean, technically, there can be some technical glitch, something you don't even know about until after you're finished and then you find out. There could be issues with actors that, for whatever reason, auditioned really well, and then you get them on the set and they don't give you what you need. Film is a pretty daunting art form. You know, it's one of the most complicated art forms on the face of the earth. All of my films really, in one way or another, have some kind of autobiographical touch to them.
You were the officer who found our father, right? Yeah, we'd like to know exactly what happened.
Once upon a time, there was a young fellow that was walking through the woods. He wondered if it'd ever come the time that he could find himself a dragon.
Dad.
Yes, Bobby.
Dad.
In a minute.
Bobby, your father's having a conversation.
Dad.
All right, Bobby, what?
Pop-Pop doesn't have his glasses.
Okay, sound?
Rolling.
Camera?
Rolling.
Take two.
Action.
I'm Roger Broadhurst, but I live right over there, and I was wondering, what's going on?
Yes, sir, can I help you?
Yes, I'm Roger Broadhurst, I live right over there, and I was wondering, what's going on?
Well, sir, due to the recent event in Memphis...
You mean the shooting of Dr. King?
Yes, sir. That's exactly what I mean.
With Tom, you just feel really comfortable on the set. He just has a way of making you feel at ease, and as a result, it's going to bring out the best performance with an actor. And there's just that trust between the actor and director.
Roger, Millie needs to go home. There's got to be a way we can get her there.
How?
One of the things I really like about Tom's work is that he's very detail-oriented. He loves to make work that is grounded in some type of historical context. And he puts a lot of thought into how that historical framework affects, you know, the production design. He's been working a lot on issues of race in his work.
The civil rights movement has been shot to death in Memphis, Tennessee.
My name is James Roger Brown. I was born in St. Paul, Minnesota, August the 22nd, 1927.
I went down to the Twin Cities, took my cameraman and some equipment. We did a series of interviews with Jim Brown, and out of those interviews came the material for Mr. Brown. And then, of course, once I had the interview material together, I realized that I wanted to do some reenactment stuff. And so I managed to sort of tie in what I would like to do most of the time, which is dramatic narrative. I managed to find a way to sort of tie in some dramatic narrative elements into this documentary portrait. We were really shocked when we found out that we won that competition.
And she said, whenever you want to see my kids, you see him at the playground like you always do. She said, but you don't come to my house.
Really, Tom was the first person to do that, to really move beyond just the talking head and use a lot of these different elements with reenactments and different scene settings. And that was one thing that really set his work apart, because he did it, and beyond him doing it, he did it just so beautifully, because he has such a soft touch to when he transitions between Mr. Brown speaking and telling his story, and then he just drifts into here he is as a boy talking about the birthday party that he went to, or going to the dance.
You can adjust your horizon line on this.
When I came here in 2004 to teach at MSU, we had about 20 majors in the program. Today, we have at least 175, and we're approaching 200. The thing that we try to instill in our students, which we feel will make them more marketable, is versatility. I think filmmakers, especially younger filmmakers, tend to make the mistake of thinking that in order for them to be legitimate, they have to be telling these grandiose stories. It has to be some kind of space opera. It has to be some kind of, you know, espionage caper. I happen to think that the most interesting stories, and in many ways the most important stories, are the small ones, the simple stories that are based on everyday experiences.
That's fine. Okay. Great, we're gonna do it again right away.
I'm surprised when things turn out well. There is a magic to it. My personal feeling is that the better directors are the ones who understand the basics in terms of storytelling and also understand the unique relationship between themselves and their actors.
Cut, okay, I'm happy with that. All right.
Walter Piehl's son, Shadd, is an artist in his own right. Shadd Piehl and the Lost Horses are a cowboy rock band from the Mandan, North Dakota area. This is a band who likes to have fun while creating a sound that is true to their Western North Dakota lifestyle. Let's listen to an original cowboy rock song by Shadd Piehl and the Lost Horses.
somewhere in Saskatchewan, and it's 3 a.m. halfway through my drive. Amadon by morning, Highway 85. Listen to the all-night trucker show, only thing on AM radio. Drive in a circle, a horse at each end. By morning I see ya, my rodeo friend. And there ain't no life after rodeo.
No life
after rodeo. Good one, missed him out again, but next one's a new horse. I'm gonna win. No money for fees, but that hot check we'll spend. Goes on the road, stays on the road. Gonna live my life by the cowboy code. Love your baby whenever you're home. And there ain't no life after rodeo.
No life
after rodeo. Diver gonna bust in half. You better cock your hammer, give her the gas, ride like you can, like there ain't no tomorrow. I'm driving all night, a radio on, lost somewhere in Saskatchewan, and it's 3 a.m. halfway through my drive. Hammered on my morning Highway 85, and there ain't no life after rodeo.
No life
after rodeo.
Woo-haw! Gee-law! Hey, Ma! Can anybody give me a yee? Powder River letter buck, too wide to ride, too fat to truck. Ladies and gentlemen, y'all better hunt your hidey holes. Stand back and get ready to be amazed, for I'm about to unwind. I've got a brass-mounted heart and cast-iron bowels. Speed, mead, greed, they all put the meat on my bones. I can whip my weight in Wolverines, ride anything with hair. 'Cause I do things the American way, say. You can be anything you wanna be, hey? Make it up as you go along, Mac, 'cause where I am is where it's at, and where I'm at, it's Dakota, and Dakota is everywhere, said Longshot O'Leary in a poem called Letter. Poem, poem, a little space out of time, sometimes rhyme, I don't wanna rhyme, make it up, a world of dreams, I've got a poem about cowboy beans. Later on in the show, 'cause cowboys are showmen who rodeo o, do o, do o.
When the sun will only shine, sundogs all the time, and the snow piles high, half a mile to the sky. Don't you worry, don't you fear. I'll be coming home, my dear, to Fargo in February. Winters there can get kind of scary, but find one to keep you warm. You make it through any storm. Winter soon turns to spring. Summer comes, and this is true, that even in August I'll still remember you. I'll come to Fargo next February, girls in long johns get kinda hairy, but that too can keep you warm. You make it through any storm. Might live in warmer climes. It's always hot and the sun does shine. Jimmy Buffett sings the tune. Even so, I'll see you soon. I'll come to Fargo next February. Winters there can get kind of scary, but find one to keep you warm. You'll make it through a month of storm.
Thanks for joining us for this edition of Prairie Mosaic. If you know of an artist, a topic, or an organization in our region that you think might make an interesting segment, please contact us at prairiemosaic@prairiepublic.org. For Prairie Mosaic, I'm Bob Dambach.
This program is funded by the North Dakota Council on the Arts, the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4th, 2008, and by the members of Prairie Public.